Thank you, Mr. Chairman, fellow panelists, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. The title of my paper is West Asia in Crisis: Sectarian Cleavages Shape Regional Conflicts. Sectarianism is a very emotive and divisive subject, and it is very difficult to obtain consensus on any remarks that are made about it. Indeed, any assertion on the one side is disparaged by the other. So I recognize that I'm getting into a complex arena. I'm presenting personal views on the basis of my own understanding, which may be flawed or inadequate, and in due course I'm confident I will be corrected. When we look at the scenario today around us in West Asia, we see two ongoing wars, the scourge of jihad, and we have the two major Islamic giants poised face to face across the Gulf. Over time, in the last 4 or 5 years, these confrontations have increasingly been shaped in sectarian terms, so that now, 5 years after the commencement of the Arab Spring, sectarianism is the key divide as articulated by the various contenders in West Asia. The Shia-Sunni divide goes back to the origins of Islam. There is a very solid body of theology in Sunni Islam that disparages Shia, and indeed in Orthodox schools does not recognize them as Muslim. Hostility to Shia is an essential part of the Hanbali school. It was then carried forward in the 13th century by Ibn Taymiyyah, and in the 18th century by Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. This is not to suggest to you that there were no other schools in Sunni Islam. The reason I am mentioning these is because they have obtained resonance today, and their remarks, possibly pulled out of context, are today quoted verbatim and very frequently in writings and in social media. When Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab wrote about the Shia, he made 3 specific criticisms about their doctrinal position. He argued that by rejecting the first 3 Khalifas, they went against the consensus of the Muslim community, which is Ijma, and therefore violated a cardinal principle of Muslim theology. They also took recourse to false hadiths in support of the claims of Hazrat Ali. And number 3, that by disparaging some of the Prophet's companions, they were abusing the Prophet's family, and that is another cardinal sin in Islam. More nearer our times, you find that this discourse never died away in doctrinal terms. In Syria, the Muslim Brotherhood, in terms of its differences with President Hafez al-Assad, took recourse to the sectarian divide and mobilized support on the basis of hostility to the Alawi community that was in the nascent stage, that had just been recognized as a Shia community, a school or a variation of the 12th Shia. In Saudi Arabia, when you had the reformist Sahwa movement, you had this intellectual, Muhammad Surur Zainul Abidin, a very, very solid anti-Shia position. And then, of course, in Iraq you had, in the context of the occupation in 2003, Abu Musab al-Zarqawi, who was not only doctrinally hostile to Shia, but also attacked Shia targets with the same vehemence and enthusiasm as he did the Americans. This is the doctrinal background. Anti-Shia position emerges from a central ideological conviction in Sunni Islam, and that is Salafiyya, so Salafism. Salafism means going back to the origins of Islam, the Quran Sharif and the Hadith, and drawing all our values and principles on the basis of our understanding of these two texts. We are guided, obviously, by various scholars who have favored us with their commentaries over the centuries. Scholars have divided Salafis into three groups. There is a group which is referred to as Quietist, but which is very rarely Quietist. It is Wahhabiyya from Saudi Arabia, broadly from the school of Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Broadly, because what we see today in the kingdom is a combination of the religious doctrines which have emerged from the Sheikh and the political interests of the royal family that have been at the helm of affairs in the kingdom from the 18th century, but more recently over the last 100 years when the kingdom has been a reality at the Arabian Peninsula. They do not believe in political activism. They do not believe in political parties. They believe in loyalty to the ruler. They believe that any attempt to overthrow the ruler causes chaos or fitna, which is the worst thing that can happen in a Muslim realm. You are allowed to give him quiet advice. The ruler can be given advice. He believes in shura, consultation, and you can give him advice, but you cannot agitate against him. Then you have mainstream or activist Salafiyya, represented most prominently by the Muslim Brotherhood. Muslim Brotherhood have borrowed the tenets of Islam and have married them with some of the tenets of parliamentary democracy. So they believe in constitutionalism, political parties, elections, a prime minister, human rights, etc. They have never seriously enjoyed power until the emergence of the government of President Morsi in Egypt and the Ennahda when they came to power in Tunisia. Therefore, they have never had the occasion to actually implement the principles that they have fine-tuned over 80 or 90 years, nearly 100 years, about 90 years. They have never been able to actually participate in popular party, in popular politics. And then you have the jihadis, known as jihadi Salafism or Salafist jihadism, who believe in implementing the tenets of the Quran and the Hadith, of seeking an ideal Muslim society in a caliphate. But they also believe that because we are surrounded by kufr, we are surrounded by evil, we are surrounded by the enemies of Islam, we have religious sanction to take up arms against them, and to defend our faith, we can participate in violence. This is the doctrinal aspect. The political aspect of Islam, the most important point to note is that Islam has never experienced wars of religion of the kind that Europe went through all through its history, or most of its history, where you had first wars between Christian sects and later on between Catholicism and Protestantism, possibly coming to an end at the end of the 30 Years' War. We had instances where Shia and Sunni empires faced each other, where there were wars fought between the Ottomans and the Safavids, but those were not wars of religion. They were imperialist wars, and I think that has defined. Possibly the reason is that very rarely did you have Shias in power, other than in Iran. We had a short period in Egypt, but otherwise, overwhelmingly, Muslim history has seen Sunnis in power and Shias, even when they were in a majority, usually as the underclass. 20th century politics is the politics not of religion, but of secular political order in an authoritarian framework. With the exception of Saudi Arabia, almost all the other rulers used to be quote-unquote secular in character. It is possible that some of the Gulf monarchies may have given lip service to a certain affiliation to Islam, But most of the others, the actual order, gave priority to the survival of the leadership rather than to any doctrinal commitment of theirs. In fact, you see, many of these were quite happy to use religion or sectarianism when it suited their political interests. When you had Iraqi mobilization against Iran, by and large the mobilization was national in character. And that is what motivated the Iraqi armies, made up largely of Shia conscripts, to fight their crow sectarian brethren, but on a basis of nationalism and upholding Arab and Iraqi identity. But the same President Saddam Hussein, in times of grave personal and political difficulty, inscribed Allahu Akbar on his flag when it suited him. Exactly the same thing happened with Hafiz al-Assad and his son, where they were otherwise Ba'athist, but their support base was Alawi, and in times of grave crisis, it is the Alawi identity that was first used at the time of the 20. Yes, they are not at the top, but you have a very large number of Sunni officers and also soldiers. So Republicans have not been particularly interested in religion and was not a factor. Therefore, sectarianism is a very, very recent development in the politics of West Asia. Till very recently, you could spend years in West Asia and the word Shia or Sunni would not be mentioned to you. I have divided the political evolution of sectarian politics into three phases. The first phase, the emergence of sectarian cleavage, I have put from 1979 to 2003. From the commencement of the Iranian Revolution up to the American occupation, where sectarianism becomes a dividing line in the political order. It's a prolonged narrative, but suffice it to say that the Islamic Revolution and the Iraq-Iran war that happened immediately thereafter consolidated a sense of identity and brought in the certain consciousness of sectarian identity. When the Iranians ended the war, they believed that when the whole world was against them, they had come out of it. They had done well. They had been poisoned. Poison gas was used against them. Nobody spoke up for them. But they had done well out of the war and had paid a very heavy price to safeguard their revolution. There was a certain sense among the Shia in Iraq and across the Gulf who felt a certain sense of resurgence, that perhaps, just perhaps, something good may happen in our life after so many years as the underclass. And yes, there were demonstrations celebrating the Iranian Revolution in the early 1980s in Bahrain and in the eastern province of Saudi Arabia. They were very quickly got rid of. And then the regimes engaged for the first time with the challenge of their own domestic communities, domestic minorities, in the majority in Bahrain, minority in Saudi Arabia, for the first time, is seriously on sectarian basis. And both of them had every reason to be concerned. Bahrain has active policies that have discriminated against the Shia. And therefore, when you go to Bahrain, it is appalling to see the shanty towns in which they live. This is not the same as in the eastern province in Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia's policies have been to empower Shia economically and educationally, because their Wahhabi state order cannot permit them to get equality in doctrinal terms or in political terms or in terms of participation in government. If that is not possible, the other has been possible. The problem in the kingdom is that that is no longer considered enough by new generations of people that have emerged. The second phase that I would put down is consolidation of the sectarian cleavage, and there I have taken 2003 to 2010. I see this commencing with the depredations of Zarqawi and then the consolidation of the sectarian divide during the prime ministership of Nuri al-Maliki. I do know that the narrative on the ground is much more complex than certain bald remarks, but the fact remains that sectarianism had become the backbone of Iraqi politics after the US occupation. And some of us would believe that it was deliberately done in order to maintain a divide and rule of record and in order to divide a robust and otherwise potentially extremely wealthy country. Whatever may have been the case, the fact remains that the early jihadi activity of Zarqawi and his successors was supported by GCC countries. But it was rejected by the Iraqi Sunni themselves in the Sahwa. They fought against the Al-Qaeda in Iraq and defeated them, hoping that they would be once again reintegrated in the nation that was their own. The failure of the Nuri Maliki government, the fear that he had from an integrated national army, the fear of a coup d'etat that he had, and actually meant that he destroyed his own army and began to depend on militia. In the case of Saudi Arabia, you find that they have two policies, sometimes one, sometimes the other. Politics of accommodation and politics of coercion. Accommodation means there would be dialogue. There would be engagement with each other. There would be promises made. There would be suggestions that, yes, we will rectify the situation on the ground that is discriminatory of you. What were the Shia asking in terms of their petitions? They wanted to be treated as equal citizens. They wanted to have government positions. They wanted to be ambassadors. They wanted to be in the armed forces. They wanted equal rights. Above all, and linked with all this, they wanted dignity. This was the constant refrain of their various remarks. And the king was, and the crown prince was responsive. He had dialogue with them. He had meetings with them. He accepted petitions from them. Some of the petitions that he got, he said that these are my petitions. He was a very strong votary of Shia, of bridging the gap between Shia and Sunnah. And it is important to note that in 2008, the OIC, in its Makkah conference, declared that the four schools of Sunni thought and the two schools of Shia heritage, that is the Twelver and the Zaydi, are equal manifestations of Islam. This was the OIC conference resolution of 2008. But there has been constantly also the other side. The clerics of Saudi Arabia have never supported the royal family in its various accommodative approach. In using initially the social media, I mean before the social media, using the internet and now the social media, they have been extremely hostile to the Shia, declaring them as non-Muslim, saying that their aspirations are not for dignity but are supportive of interests outside the border, supportive of Iran. They have called for jihad, Saudi youth to participate in the jihad in Iraq and support Zarqawi. An appeal that actually meant several thousand Saudis actually went across to Iraq as part of the ISI later on, the ISI. So this appeal had. Hezbollah was stigmatized as the party of Satan because there was a concern that its star was rising. It had been powerful enough. It had stood up to the Israelis that no other Arab had done in several decades. Had taken a very bad beating, but had come out stronger in 2006. This was called Party of Satan. There was also criticism of the Crown Prince, later the King's own moderation and initiatives, saying that they reject the suggestion of the OIC that they can be considered equal, that the Twelver and the Zaydis can be considered Muslim. They are the worst and they are the most sinful. And some of the words I have used in my paper, I don't need to repeat them over here. The third part of the political evolution has been from 2011 till now. That is the commencement of the Arab Spring. The Arab Spring had a twofold challenge to Saudi Arabia, a domestic challenge of reform and a strategic challenge in the region with the fall of Hosni Mubarak and the reform demand in Bahrain. So what you see today is the coming together of two separate streams of sectarianism, of sectarian politics. The stream from Iraq that divided that created cleavages within Iraq and then was adopted by the jihadis and is today central to the Islamic State, and the tradition of sectarian animosity that you had in Saudi Arabia. These two streams are today coalesced. In the concerns that Saudi Arabia had, the twin concerns of domestic challenge and regional challenge vis-a-vis because of the fall of Hosni Mubarak, it then articulated its intervention in terms of military intervention in Bahrain and support for various Islamic groups and Salafi groups for regime change in Syria. And then, of course, you have Yemen. In Yemen, too, Saudi Arabia has been very actively involved with the politics of that country. It has a 1400 kilometer border. It is a very turbulent border and has been one for several decades. They have a legitimate concern that the empowerment of the Zaidi in the shape of the Houthi community could possibly emerge as a threat to them. And it is the considered view of the kingdom that the Houthi agitation is directly supported from Iran, even if scholars have been consistently saying that there is no evidence of this in this regard. Indeed, most of the agitations that have happened in Bahrain and in the Eastern Province and now with regard to the Houthis, most of scholarship suggests that these are national agitations taking place within a national framework and seeking amelioration of their condition within the national borders, and that Iran has had a very insignificant role in this regard. Be that as it may, we have today the scenario of sectarianism as central to the Islamic State. So that the environment of sectarianism has today been taken over by the zeal and by the violence of the Islamic State. And then you are aware of what has happened. Recently, in response to this challenge of Iran, which is a strategic challenge, and the challenge of jihad from the Islamic State, there have been certain initiatives taken centered around the kingdom. Number one, the setting up of the Islamic Military Alliance, which certain scholars have suggested is a Sunni alliance, 34 countries getting together, setting up a strategic cooperation with Turkey, and then executing 43 people for terrorist activity at home. 43 are Al-Qaeda and 4 are Shia. What is the scenario overall today? Number one, there is today a deep cleavage, a deep sense that sectarianism today is central to political mobilization across the region. It has not yielded military success. The conflict in Syria and the conflict in Yemen appear to be going towards stalemate. Lot of bloodshed, lot of destruction, but nobody can say that we have had total victory. Possibly because till now the kingdom has not shown any interest in negotiation or dialogue. It wants total victory. Regime change in Damascus and the elimination of the Houthis as a military force in Yemen. State order is collapsing because of all these conflicts, Iraq, Syria and Yemen, and jihadi penetration is therefore a viable reality. There is a certain coming together of the West and GCC, but in very crass commercial terms. If there is no serious political activity that you can see from the West, there is an end to Western hegemony in the region. They are basically looking at defense contract, which the GCC is very happily giving to them. What is my view, therefore, about the future? Most of the writers today have a very bleak view about the outlook for West Asia, largely because of the sectarian divide, the scourge of jihad, and the confrontation between Iran and Saudi Arabia. I am going to give you the opposite view. I believe that the worst that could have happened in our region has possibly happened. And from here, stalemate is not an option, because the forces that are at play do not believe in stalemate. So things can only deteriorate very rapidly further. And the further you go, the possibility of a direct conflict between Iran and Saudi Arabia cannot be ruled out as a possibility, if you allow the present scenario to continue. I believe this is not likely to happen. And these are my reasons. Number one, sectarianism, according to me, in the political arena, has no depth. There is very little historic support for it. Even in recent years, very rarely have governments used the sectarian identity as an aspect of governmental order. They have today, there is a shaping of the sectarian impulse primarily through non-official channels. But as government policy, by and large, you will see that it is not, governance is not articulated in sectarian terms. Secondly, it has been a tool, primarily a tool for political mobilization in an environment of strategic challenge. But even here, I am going to say to you that it is a weak weapon. Saudi Arabia, Egypt, and Turkey are supposed to be three pillars of a Sunni alliance in the region. They hardly agree on any serious issue. Egypt has very little comfort with regard to sectarianism, as does Turkey. With regard to the Muslim Brotherhood and mainstream Islam, Turkey is a strong supporter of the Brotherhood. Egypt is strongly opposed to it. And Saudi Arabia is flirting with the Syrian Brotherhood in Damascus and the Islam Party in Yemen. And then you have jihad. Islamic State benefited from the active engagement, active support that was initially given to it by Turkey. Firstly, we know Zarqawi himself flourished on the basis of GCC support. More recently, jihadis were given a free ride across the Turkish-Syrian border. And today we have not seen terribly high enthusiasm in Ankara about bombing the ISIS out of existence. And the Al-Qaeda. The Saudis are working with Al-Qaeda actively in Syria. They are the members of Jaish al-Fatah, active members of Jaish al-Fatah, because they are the most decent fighting force in that country. If you're going to achieve regime change, you need Jabhat Nusra on your side. And how much damage have they done on Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula? Not one bomb has fallen on Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, though more bombs have fallen in Yemen than the Americans had thrown onto Iraq in 2003. Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula is a menace in South Yemen. So that even if you annihilate the Houthis physically or as a political force or any other force, you are going to have the monster of Al-Qaeda right there. And of course, Islamic State has also emerged there. Therefore, I believe that there is no future whatsoever in sectarian mobilization whatsoever. And what was all this about? To keep the demand for reform off the table? But it's not dead. It's still there. The Sahwa movement in Saudi Arabia took birth in the early 1990s. And every form of state coercion has been inflicted upon them. But they are alive today, not physically, but virtually. And they have very strong agendas. And ultimately, all of us who are well-wishers of the kingdom know that the present order is not sustainable. And that there will be reform. And it will be reform that will be led by sections of the royal family. To conclude, I think the situation has reached rock bottom. I believe that the ground has been prepared for an end of this kind of nonsensical sectarian cleavage, and that possibly sooner rather than later you will see an Iranian-Saudi engagement, possibly facilitated by certain other parties, including India. Thank you.